step backwards to the phase of research which is part of the nephrology spectrum that we have to, that leads us to the clinical applications and translation in medicine in nephrology. My talk will be mainly confined to the application or implementation of cell cultures in experimental research in general, and then with focus in the field of experimental nephrology. As we may we have experienced during our research work, that when we talk about experiments, we think of the in vivo models used for experimental animal. But we have to take into consideration that nowadays cell cultures, it's only not only nowadays, but this goes back to the early 20th century, using cell cultures for experimental research, either as pilot studies or complementary designs for the in vivo designs in experimental animals. And if we compare the privileges of each of these approaches, we can see that cell cultures provide a model giving the researcher a large number of cells and implementing or realizing the 3R requirements for experimental research, which is the replacement and reduction of using experimental animals, as well as providing results that would lead to refinement of research results and innovation. There are certain obstacles that we face when we use in vivo experimental animals, which are comprised within the issue that the animal strains are not all standardized for and give the same responses when you are applying your research plan. This is one fact. Both approaches, whether cell cultures or cell animal models, have their risks. The most important risk for cell culture is contamination, a risk that would give a breakdown to all your trials and waste all the efforts and costs that have been implemented during the experiment. On the other hand, speaking about animal models, we are confronted here with the high mortality rates among the animal models. But again, for culture, cell culture experiments, here we have a very good privilege, which is time saving. These studies are all usually of a short term that can help gaining many data instead of the long time periods applied for experimental research. And if we are talking cost-wise, let's say that nowadays, with our conditions, it's nearly the same expenses, so you are not saving money anymore. And as I said, the using of cell cultures is goes back to the early 20th century, when they started to isolate cells. It became more prominent after the opening the field for culture media, for providing the ideal standardized methods for culturing. And the big era began after the isolation of individual cells. The most important or the most famous one was the isolation of cancer cells, particularly those, the HeLa cells for cancer cervix. So, just to get a general idea or a basic idea, a cell culture is simply a group of cells that you separate from a particular tissue, whether it is a human tissue, a plant, or an animal tissue. Then you put them in the right environment and allow them to grow. The first yield that comes out of the culturing or of the separated cells, this is what we call the primary culture. And the separation of cells from a tissue, it's a process which can go by mechanical methods or enzymatic methods. And, it is, and the first culture, this primary cell culture, can then be subject to different methodologies that depend upon the purpose of the study you are conducting. If we select a particular population from the primary tissue or from the culture that we get, this is what we call a cell stream. For example, if we are studying fibroblasts per se or epidermal cells per se. But if we take the whole result and then pass it through several following culture or subcultures, this is what we call subclones or subcultures. The resulting cultures could be then either of a short period of duration, which we call effeminate culture, or they could be propagated for extended passages over 20, 25 or more passages that lead them to spontaneous transformation. And here these then get acquire the property for continuous proliferation. Therefore, they are called then the continuous transformed populations. We can induce this continuity from primary culture by applying a process known as immortalization of the resulting cells. There are certainly differences between the behavior or in the culture cells, whether if we are talking about fennet cell lines or we are talking about continuous cell lines. They behave differently regarding the liability for adherence, the proliferation rate, the preservation of the genetic traits and genetic profiles from the original tissue they come from, and the dependence on growth factors and stability, and genetic stability. So cell cultures could include either tissues in which we have separated stem cells, or we are isolating precursor cells, or we are dealing with differentiated cells. The application for cell culture depends on your purpose. What's your target? But cell culture models provide very good models if you are dealing with normal cells to study cell biology, to study the genotypic profiling for particular cells, for studying the metabolism, the chemistry, and the normal morphology or genotypic profiling for cells. Again, they can be used as models for drug testing, for pharmaceutical applications. They have also been used for cancer research and genetic research, and lately they have been also used as sources for producing particular products that we can use in clinical applications, for example, antibodies for vaccine production or for hormone production. The morphology of cells in culture depend on the nature of the culture. If we are talking about fennet cultures, these tend to take the form of monolayers with anchorage properties, and these are usually the normal fennet cultures. This is opposite to cells which are less, which are of the continuous behavior or continuous pattern. Here, these cells usually tend to form floating aggregates of cells, and you can be grown in suspensions. Now, back to the primary cell cultures, although they are the source for the different cell lines that we want to establish, yet the uses for primary cultures as they are is a relatively limited. They mainly are used for embryonic cells, and or we can isolate from them the single cells or separate cells for studying models of cell biology. and they are the main source for establishing subsequent cell lines. The limitations for these primary cell cultures is that they are of short lifespan. And actually, as lab effectiveness, their formation and establishment needs a lot of time and growth factors, media, which is tailored according to the primary cell culture that we are dealing with. One other obstacle is that if in some primary cell cultures, especially if we are talking about the stem cell primary cell cultures, you cannot apply growth factors to enhance proliferation of these cells, because growth factors would then, or serum, or these promoting substances, supplements, would enhance differentiation of the mesenchymal cells or of the stem cells in general. So you are losing the main feature of these cells to be used for further study. Also, if the culture is not a pure culture and contains other cell types, addition of these supplements would cause promotion of the growth of other cell types beside the targeted cells, so that we get a contaminated cell line. One other important factor is, as much as we have labs and centers worldwide, there are generally no standardized protocols for propagation of these primary culture. It prevents on the lab criteria, the lab environment, and factors in the lab rather than standardized methodologies that could be universally applied. So the alternative is the establishment of cell lines to provide a method or a material upon which we can conduct research by in a culture that goes by several propagations and passages and can proliferate in an indefinite way. These cell lines could be either of normal cells, they could be stem cells, and they could be cancer stem cells. Each of these could be brought into this cell line property by either being left as they are to get a finite cell line with a short lifespan, or a continuous cell line by bringing them into immortalization. By immortalization, we mean that we enhance the elongation of the telomere, a part of the DNA, so that the cell cycle would be continuously going on without the cell going into senescence. These immortalized cells are not necessarily carcinogenic cells. Some normal cells could be brought into immortalization, but they have an infinite way for proliferation. They have low anchorage dependence and they can grow without growth factors. How is this immortalization brought? There are several methods. The initial methods included the gene transfection with viruses. Then comes the era for enhancement of the telomere by using irradiation or chemical agent, until we come today to the era of genetic editing with the CRISPR editing methodologies that allows the enhancement of the telomerase and suppression of oncogenes. Let's also remember that this immortalization happens spontaneously in some cell lines, especially in the cancer cell lines. Now, referring to the cell line applications in nephrology, we can speak about normal cell lines as well as the cancer cell lines, which are today very important tools for nephrology research. Regarding the normal cell lines, these are either derived from human beings or from animals. There are well-established cell lines for the different epithelial types of the kidney, starting from the renal tubules and from the renal interstitium, as well as from the urinary bladder. All animal species have been also used for separation of these or establishment of animal kidney cell lines, and they have been used as very good examples in nephrology research. So, is it 1 minute or? Okay. So today we have suppliers that are mainly concerned with the selling of cell lines, and I'll just go rapidly through examples of these cell lines and how they are applied in research in nephrology. For example, the human epithelial proximal epithelial cells, which are good models for studying metabolism, energy depletion. Another more specified normal cell line are derived from the convoluted as well as from the straight portions of the proximal tubules, and these have been used effectively for studying drug resistance, particularly chemotherapeutic drugs. More also, a novel cell line are the collecting cells, which are used for studying the aldosterone-dependent cells and the mechanisms explaining the regulation of iron transport. Another important or interesting cell line is the HEK293, which is one of the early cell lines used in nephrology, and these cells have been derived from embryo, human embryo, and used for research, particularly that concerning the biotherapeutic protein expression production and electrophysiological experiments. From the interesting cell lines derived from dogs are the MDCK cell lines, which are used to study the cell adhesion mechanisms and cell polarity expressed or in the tubular epithelium of the kidney. The other field is the field for cell lines in cancer kidney, and these are either removed during nephrectomy if they are differentiated tumors, or they are removed from metastasizing cells if they are undifferentiated. These cells can then be re-implanted into xenografts in nude or skin mice to conduct further experiments for testing tumorigenicity. And one important factor for conducting this type of research is the site of inoculation, in which the inoculation at the same site of origin of these cells in the experimented animal has proven to give better results than just given by intravenous or other approaches. But here we are facing the fact that these cancer cells have to be verified from many aspects regarding their markers and their genotypic typing and their morphology. Generally speaking, the renal cancer cells have been divided into or are used to be verified according to the main three classes of renal cell carcinoma, which is the clear cell variety, the papillary type, and the chromophore type. A long list or growing list of renal cell carcinoma cell lines is established by many cell banks. And the last category is the stem cells for the renal cell cancer. And this is a growing era for research. These cells have also their own criteria to be verified with. Practically speaking, and from our experience at our lab, when we use cell lines, it's not practical to decide to establish a primary cell culture. It's expensive, time consuming. So the alternative is to use produce cells either by buying them from cell culture banks or from other labs, but in these, as well as the problems that if we get from other labs or from the local agencies, for example, like Valsera, that these cells, we don't get an identification card for them. We don't know their identity and clear authentication for these cell lines. And this gives a lot of misinterpretation for the results. As I said, a lot of marketing suppliers are now available for providing these cell lines, which where they buy the cells from reputed or certified cell banks like the ATCC or the European Collection of Animal Cell Lines. And these banks are reputed because they follow very strict and expensive methods for investigation, including karyotyping for the cells, PCR fragment analysis, DNA sequencing, and else, to be sure about the data profile for each cell line that comes out of these banks. So whenever you are dealing with a cell line, you have to be sure that you get its full data sheet, including its sterility, that it is free from contamination, its genome profiling, its tumorigenicity, culture media, and so on. And as precaution, what you do when you receive these cells, it's better to be quarantined in separate CO2 incubators and laminar rooms until you have tested and verified they're free from contamination. The least thing you can do, that you can test the originality of these cell lines by going through the data sheet or databases for the international cell line, and is that as we are starting labs dealing with cell cultures, that we need to select the proper cell line that we will work on, because this will determine if you are going to use normal cells, cancer cells, continuous cell lines, or infinite cell lines. And also you have to be sure about the availability of the requirements for these cells. Also, we have to take into consideration that we have to work under the umbrella of the approved research ethics and standards, because at the end, we are dealing with living cells. Thank you very much.